It is indeed a pleasure to be here this afternoon on behalf of the Government of Canada to talk about the strength of the Canadian economy, the challenges that we face to achieve long-term prosperity, and the solutions that we have to those challenges if we all understand and all know how we can work together a little better. Now, I know that Minister of Natural Resources, Joe Oliver, was here yesterday, and he told you everything that you needed to know. So I know that my responsibilities and my job will be a little easier here this afternoon. But in all seriousness, I do have the privilege of speaking on behalf of Jason Kenney, Minister of Employment and Social Development. He sends his regrets that he could not join us today. I am very pleased to meet with you for the first time since becoming a Minister of State for Finance. And let me tell you, folks, it's certainly been a remarkable experience to work alongside the strong leadership of our Prime Minister Harper, but also to work with Minister Jim Flaherty. Their leadership has helped to navigate Canada through the worst recession in a generation. Together, we are steadfast in our resolve to protect the Canadian economy and to balance the budget. Now, I know that the leader of the Liberal Party thinks that budgets magically balance themselves, but you folks, those who run businesses that keep this economy humming, know that that is not the case. It takes sound economic policy, but it also takes fiscal discipline. And I am pleased to tell you that our government's prudent, responsible plan for the Canadian economy is working. Just this morning, Statistics Canada announced the Canadian economy grew 2.9% in the last quarter of 2013. Earlier this week, Stats Canada also confirmed that Canadian families are better off today under our Conservative government than under previous governments. They found that the net worth of Canadian families was up more than 44% since 2005. Indeed, the Canadian economy has experienced one of the best performances among the G7 countries over the recovery in terms of both output and job creation. Since the depth of the global recession, employment has increased by over 1 million, the strongest job growth among the G7 countries. This year, Canada leapt from sixth position to second position in Bloomberg's rankings of best places in the world to do business. Both the IMF and the OECD expect Canada to be among the strongest growing economies in the G7 over this year and next. Looking forward, opportunities for Canada are remarkable. They're enormous. We have just reached our most ambitious trade agreement ever with the European Union, an agreement that will boost trade, will boost investments, and will create more jobs for Canadians. The benefits of this agreement are equivalent to creating almost 80,000 new jobs or increasing the average Canadian household annual income by $1,000. Here in Canada, hundreds of major resource projects worth $650 billion could come on stream over the next decade, from hydroelectricity and mining to oil sands and liquefied natural gas. The infrastructure that will be needed to extract these resources, to process them, and to ship them to market is creating a construction boom in Canada. As you know, the future is bright for Canada's nuclear industry. And the importance of your sector's contribution to the Canadian economy cannot be underestimated. According to a study by the Canadian Energy Research Institute, Canada's nuclear reactors contribute $6.6 billion per year to our GDP. I was interested to learn just yesterday, as we were looking at coming and speaking to your conference here this weekend, or this week, that your industry brings in $1.5 billion in government revenue and generates some $1.2 billion in exports. Now again, I'm the Minister of State for Finance, so I'm always interested in how much is coming into the government revenue. The nuclear power industry also employs 60,000 Canadians. According to the Canadian manufacturers and exporters, these jobs are long-lasting, as long as 50 years, and are well-paying, averaging $100,000 a year. In fact, after learning this yesterday, I wondered, you know, maybe I'm in the wrong profession. What am I doing here? But it's good jobs, good Canadian jobs, and good futures for young Canadians. But in all seriousness, in addition to the countless spin-off industries, the nuclear industry is largely employing those who have been traditionally underrepresented in the economy. For example, employees at Canada's uranium mines are over 45% Aboriginal, and nearly 50% are northern residents. There is also tremendous growth potential in your industry. Canada has the second largest uranium deposits in the world, and production is projected to double over the next 5 years. We have an excellent track record of leading edge reactor technology, a stable regulatory system, and a network of universities and research centers to support research and development. But if Canada is to move this economy forward, we must take full advantage of the opportunities in this sector. Your theme is the next generation. You recognize the potential. You recognize the opportunities. But we must maximize the opportunities afforded to us by the free trade agreement with Europe. However, it also means that we will need to ensure that we have the skilled workforce that employers are going to need. In the coming years, 40% of professional engineers and technical support staff in Canada's nuclear sector are set to retire. According to Engineers Canada, 95,000 professional engineers are projected to retire by 2020. Your own association tells us that 50% of electricity generation workers are eligible for retirement in the next 5 to 10 years. This builds on even greater skills shortage across the Canadian economy. In the next 10 years, Canada is expected to need 319,000 new workers in the construction sector, 145,000 new workers in the mining sector, 130,000 new workers in the petroleum sector, and 60,000 new workers in the forestry sector. This means that you're going to have stiff competition for people. Skills Canada tells us that we're going to need 1 million skilled trade workers by 2020. The Conference Board of Canada says that Ontario alone is losing out on more than $24 billion in economic activity because employers can't find people with the skills that they need. At the same time that we have employers desperate to find qualified workers, we have unemployed Canadians who cannot find work. Right now, nearly 1.4 million Canadians are unemployed, while there are 216,000 job vacancies in the private sector. We have this paradox. We have too many people without jobs, but at the same time, we have too many jobs without people. All too often, applicants are available for jobs, but cannot meet the necessary skill set which is needed in order for the job to go, and in other words, then the job goes unfilled. So projects don't get off the ground, Canada's economy suffers, because we have this skill gap. One area the federal government is taking action to meet this challenge is in supporting apprentices in Canada. After all, skilled trades play an important role in our economy and in our society, and they really deserve more respect. Apprenticeship training is a key provider of vital skills and knowledge necessary to power and grow the Canadian economy. You know better than anyone that your sector touches almost every aspect of our lives, from the homes we live in, to the cars we drive, to the food that we eat. We need to encourage more Canadians to turn to the skilled trades in increasing numbers, especially apprenticeships. Skilled tradespeople are in demand all across this country. As the baby boom generation retires, that demand is only going to increase. People in skilled trades are rewarded for their effort with good pay and doing work that they can be proud of, as their work, again, is vital to Canada's economy. But as you know, apprentices in skilled trades can face significant costs to getting their ticket, including training fees, tools and equipment, living expenses, and foregone wages while they're off at college or off at their training. So while the number of apprentices completing training and obtaining certification has doubled from 2000 to 2011, apprenticeship completion rates still have only averaged 50% over the same period of time. I found that intriguing. The number of apprentices completing training has doubled from 2000 to 2011, but at the same time, 50% of those who enter training don't finish and complete their courses. That's a problem. I see this problem firsthand as a minister from Alberta. And that's why I was particularly pleased that Economic Action Plan 2014 proposes the new Canada Apprentice Loan. This initiative will provide apprentices which are registered in their first Red Seal trade with access to interest-free loans of up to $4,000 per period of technical training. This initiative will assist more apprentices in completing their training and encourage more Canadians to consider a career in the skilled trades. Economic Action Plan 2014 also proposes to improve the flexibility and innovation when training apprentices through a new pilot project. The pilot project will test new approaches to apprentice training, including the use of in-class simulators, e-learning modules, remote learning sites, and video conferencing. The project will test the alternatives to the block training approach that exists across most of the country in order to allow apprentices to continue working and earning while fulfilling the training requirements of the program. Another way to address our skills shortage is to bring in more skilled immigrants and get them working in their areas of expertise as quickly as possible. To do that, we need to make more progress on foreign credential recognition. We get 250,000 newcomers every year to Canada, but too many of them are doing jobs that are well below their abilities. Too many foreign-trained professionals are driving taxis and waiting tables because of the lengthy and expensive process they have to go through in order to have their recognition and experience recognized in Canada. This is a terrible waste of human potential, and it's a serious, serious loss to our economy. And that's why our government has invested $50 million to develop a national framework to streamline foreign credential recognition for key occupations. We've been meeting with regulatory authorities representing occupations like engineers, physicians, technicians, and others to learn the best ways to streamline their credential recognition. Together with the provinces and the territories, we've committed to a one-year timeline in the recognition of these credentials in all jurisdictions across Canada. But we admit that there's still more that can be done. There's still more to do. The final solution that I would like to speak about today is the creation of the Canada Job Grant. And I'm very pleased to say, as many of you know, that today Minister Kenny has announced an agreement in principle with 12 of the provinces or territories on this exciting program. Now, instead of the bureaucrats in Ottawa deciding what kind of training you need for your industry, we're putting those decisions back into your hands. After all, you, the employers, know better than anyone else what skills your employees are going to need. As a government, we want to work with you. Right now, we're spending too much just on training for the sake of training. We need training for real jobs. Under the Canada Job Grant, businesses will be able to apply for training subsidy for a specific person for a guaranteed job. By requiring matching funds from employers, the Canada Job Grant encourages employers to up their game. According to the Conference Board survey, in the last 20 years, employer investment in workplace training in Canada has declined by 40%. Canadian businesses spend about 35% less on workplace or employee training than those in the United States, our chief competitor. By working with you, we can get that investment back up and link training to guaranteed jobs. Now, in conclusion, listen, Canada is the envy of the world. Canada is the envy of many, many other nations. And the success of our businesses is absolutely key to our continued prosperity. We came through the recent global recession better than any other country in the Western world. We have hundreds of billions of dollars in resource projects under development. And we have a wealth of jobs opening up in exciting new years over the next few coming years. We truly have an opportunity to lead the world in security and prosperity. For a young man or a young woman coming out of university or technical training institute, the opportunities have never been better. And I believe that if we make the right choices today about our labor market, there is absolutely no limit as to what we can do, to what we can fulfill tomorrow. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to be with you today.